Aitape. Now, it may be in here. I don't know. I grabbed it fast. Just okay. Yes, 282. Wait a minute. 282. Approach to the Philippines in the Southwest Pacific, General MacArthur's American and Australian forces, see? Spring of 1944, they'd neutralized the Japanese at Bougainville, New Ireland, New Britain. All right, a third Japanese army of some 60,000 held the northern coast of New Guinea from Madang to the Moluccas. Yeah. While American and Australian troops faced the enemy before Madang, an amphibious expedition was prepared in the Admiralty Islands to land behind the enemy and cut his line of communications.
And that was you at Aitape.
Which ran along the coast because the interior of New Guinea was impassable jungle. Since the U.S. Navy controlled the sea, the enemy's only escape would be flight into the mountains, jungles. Okay, the U.S. 41st Division, supported by a powerful American fleet with carrier planes, et cetera, et cetera, secured beachheads, the northern New Guinea coast. Within 4 days, all three airfields were in American hands. An Australian division, which landed near Badang, advanced 80 miles up the coast toward Wewak and Aitape. In the course of a month, and finally, we were with them, that bunch. So this was, they say, June 15th, 1944. So it was before the Philippines, because Leyte was June 15th, 44. Now, wait a minute, Leyte, okay, this will give it to me. Leyte, 358.
You've been carrying that book around how long? You've been carrying that book around how long?
I picked it up at about 1949, 1950, something like that. Okay, 1358. The invasion of Leyte. October 21st, 44. So it was before Leyte. It was after Kwajalein.
Okay. Because I think we ended the last one. We were at Kwajalein.
Kwajalein. Okay. I didn't want to miss... and have some guy say he was all wrong and say he's lying.
God forbid.
The studio.
No, but that's all right. Will this pick me up?
Yes.
I don't have to shout.
This is the state of New York's finest.
Yeah. Oh.
So, let's see. We're doing our second interview with Mr. Yeah. Paul Elisha. It is November 28th, 2001. We're Latham headquarters. Paul, I believe we ended up...
Wait a minute, is this going?
Yeah,
shut it off while I blow my...
Okay,
let's do it.
So I think we ended up the last time with Kwajalein.
Yeah, we were at Kwajalein. When last we left
when
our hero...
our hero was...
was at Kwajalein.
Now...
With the 7th Division.
How was it you ended up on the first wave all the time? Is there a...
Well, I mean, that's by design. Several of us used to say it was by design of our company commander who didn't like us. We saw that we got assigned. Maybe we should talk a little about this, the whole concept of the JASCO, the Joint Assault Signal Company. The concept of the JASCO came out of the initial commando raid on Makin Island, which was almost a year before the actual invasion, by some Marine raiders with Jimmy Roosevelt and Colonel what was his name? Carlson. Carlson's Raiders. And that was actually a probing operation, one, to see just how well fortified some of these islands were and what sort of defenses the Japanese had there. That was a commando raid by the Marines off of submarines, as I recall. And out of that, one of the ideas that came out of that was that for effective amphibious assaults, what would be needed for the initial assault was a combat team of communications people.
This was a combined arms.
Yeah, the way it worked out in this first outfit, although we were called the 75th Joint Assault Signal Company, that I think 75th had some connotation with various units, but it was the first, literally the first of its kind ever put together in the armed forces. And in that unit were Navy, artillery, Air Force, Marine, and Signal Corps people.
Now, when you hit the beach, who did you report to?
We were under the command of whoever was in charge of the initial assault.
Okay.
But we reported back to the entire invasion commander, whoever that comm ship was. That's where we were tied to.
Okay, at Saipan it would have been Holland Smith.
Yeah, or his communications people, or whoever were coordinating the assault. The idea being that until all the forces get ashore, somebody has to coordinate the communications with the people that are there back to the ships, and also to provide whatever support is needed. So, for instance, if we were to land, we'd find heavy defenses in pillboxes that couldn't be destroyed by whatever we had with us. We would report back coordinates that were given to us. We would report back we need either an airstrike or we need gunfire. Now, until on a fairly large island, until you get inshore so you can land heavy equipment, you don't have any artillery support. You might have a few small mortars with you, but most of what you've got are machine guns, BARs, and small arms. So if you need heavy support, you don't have artillery, you call out to the ships, and either a destroyer would come in close in with 5-inch guns and act as your artillery support, laying down a barrage in front of you, or you could call out to the bigger cruisers and battleships with their 16 inchers, you know, and they could lob them in that way. So for that, you needed spotters, forward observers, or you needed air officers that could talk back with the aircraft carriers, bring in air strikes. And that's what the unit was, and also communications people like myself to actually send the information.
You operated in teams of how many?
You'd have a radio. You'd have one SCR-284, the large one with the generator. You'd have a couple of backpacked radios, and then with you, you'd have a few people for fire support if you ran into a hard time, to support the whatever setup you your communications setup you had when you dug in. If it was possible, you might have a Jeep with an SCR-284 on it, so you'd have a driver and a guy with him with a submachine gun or something. But they were combat units, literally small combat teams, we called them. And there might be about a platoon has how many in it now? What's a platoon strike? All right, let's say this would be about 18 or 20 in a combat team.
And who was usually
You'd have a lieutenant and a sergeant along. We had a staff sergeant plus a lieutenant, and then other enlisted rates, et cetera, to handle stuff. And then you would have with you also either naval air officer to do the airstrikes. You'd have an artillery officer and a couple of supporting enlisted people to do whatever communications he needed. And we would set up a communications headquarters right there on the beach.
What did you have for security? Did you have an organic?
What do you mean by security?
Well,
until the battle moved off the beach, you were lying with your face in the sand, okay, using whatever firearms you had as part of the overall assault. I mean, you weren't just going to lay there. So they depended on you to add whatever help you could, which we did, you know. Then as the battle moved in, we would quickly set up the unit, and then we were responsible for communications. Now, for security, you would have maybe a light machine gun, BAR, some other people with submachine gun, Thompsons. Or
they were doing other things. Yeah.
They were also messengers. They were, you know, everybody did a little of everything.
Gotcha.
Because things were pretty chaotic always in those first waves.
Yeah, you were a radio man?
I was a Corporal Tech 5, high-speed radio operator is what my rating was.
And the radio you used was the SCR?
I've used walkie-talkies, I've used the backpack. I forget the nomenclature for that backpack, which was a lousy radio, by the way. All you had to do was drop it and it was out. The SCR 284 was a workhorse, really. You couldn't kill it.
What was the
range on it? Oh, out to the ships, or, you know, it was a good 20, 40 miles you could go with it. Interesting things, like we had talked about Attu, and I don't know if I had mentioned or not, when we went in on Attu, we had to, the combat team I was with established a communications post with the 7th Division Rangers on top of a mountain overlooking the valley where the main assault was coming. And I still remember setting that thing up and fiddling with the dials. It was dark as could be out. And I brought in Radio Vladivostok from, you know, across the Bering Sea, picked it up. And I heard Tchaikovsky there. So that gives you an idea. Of course, it was a skip frequency, I'm sure, but I did pick it up. But the SCR, it was a tough set. And on Makin, as a matter of fact, that set saved my life. Because when we went in on the Makin assault, if you've read anything about the assaults on both Makin and Tarawa, the Marines went into Tarawa, we went into Makin with the 165th Infantry. And there was a phenomenon that year with tides that made it difficult for the Navy to plot the exact time of the tides. And they screwed up badly with the Makin assault and Tarawa assaults. Mm-hmm. In order to have an effective landing, you had to have the high tide so you could get over the reef where the atoll was and into the lagoon so that the Higgins boats could take you in on the beach. Well, what happened was they screwed up on the time and the tide wasn't high enough, and all the Higgins boats, the Navy boats, got caught, their bottoms got caught on the reef. So they had to drop the ramps and let us off in the lagoon rather than on the beach, and we had like 150 yards to go in the water, as you can see there. the Japanese would have machine guns, all with crossfire, of course, and they opened up with those. On Makin, as we were going in, I still remember, I was carrying that SCR 284, which was wrapped in this rubberized stuff. It was all waterproof. And evidently in the shelling beforehand, a bomb of some kind, a shell, had made a crater in the water. I stepped into that thing and went down just as the machine guns opened up. And right after that picture was taken that you're looking at there, the machine guns opened up and guys on either side of me, I came up and they were lying in the water face down. And the only thing that saved me was that I stepped in that hole, pulled myself up onto that floating radio, and kicked myself ashore.
How was the intelligence usually, how accurate was it?
It was fairly accurate, except I would say that the assessments were always on the underside rather than the overside. For instance, General Howland Mad Smith of the Marines, who was in charge of that, the Gilbert Islands set to, you know, he gave us a hard time because it took us several days to subdue that island, and he wanted it done immediately. And he said you should have been braver and done a frontal assault on the pillboxes. Didn't matter how many people died. And they told us there were only about less than 1,800 to 2,000 Japanese on there. Well, after that battle was over, I remember when we went back down to get on the boats to go back out to the ships, we passed about a quarter of a mile of stacked bodies like cordwood. And if that was 1,800 Japanese, it was more like 4,000 or so. So in many cases, they underestimated the number. They were fair, you know, I mean, it wasn't a horrendous miscalculation, but there always seemed to be more than they thought there were. Also, the state of their preparedness was usually either they were better prepared than we thought, or they just were stubborn as hell.
Now, just before Aitape was where?
Kwajalein.
Kwajalein.
Yeah, and then, yeah. On the way, then we were, from there, we were supposed to go to prepare to the Admiralty Islands, where they were preparing a convoy for the Philippines invasion. But in the meantime, there had been some landings on the New Guinea coast, and I believe at Hollandia, but it was decided, MacArthur decided to do some of that hedge hopping on the way to the Philippines to make it easier for supply and airfields so that he could use land-based planes for bomber support. So they landed at New Guinea, and we were attached, some of us were attached to the 7th Australian Brigade, which were the Rats of Tobruk, which was being brought back to Australia in increments.
What were the Aussies like?
The Aussies were very casual about it at all. As a matter of fact, I remember we were attached for communications purposes. And there were, with each patrol that would go out, there'd be like a patrol of 15 or 16 Australians on this perimeter at Aitape, New Guinea. And there would be like four of us radio people sent along. The Japanese, who really never showed themselves in strength, did a lot of sniper stuff and, you know, hit and run things. And they would love to climb up into the, it was very jungly. And they would love to climb up into trees, and they'd tie themselves up there, and they'd wait for whoever came along, and they'd hit you with sniper fire. And if they missed, that was it for them, because these guys were very blasé about it. A shot would ring out, somebody would say, "Sniper," like that. They'd turn around and they'd just spray everything in sight. You'd see the bodies drop out of the trees. And I can still remember, you'd be going along in a patrol, you might have just had a hit from a sniper or two, and they'd return the fire, get rid of them, and somebody'd say, "Oh, it's 4 o'clock, tea time." And they'd stop everything, set up these little alcohol lamps, take out their canteens, and they'd sit around on their haunches and brew a pot of tea. And the whole war would stop for tea.
What'd you think of that?
Well, we didn't mind. You know, we got to know it. The one thing we didn't like about them was that they drank warm beer. They would carry bottles of it along, and they thought the Americans were crazy to drink cold beer. But I remember that distinctly. Anyway,
the Americans tend to get along with the Australians?
Yeah, we got along. We would josh each other a lot, you know. They'd tell us all about Tobruk, and we would tell them about our battles. You know, we'd swap battle stories. Mm-hmm. And we got along fine with them. They were easygoing people, the Aussies, not like the British at all.
Good fighters?
Hmm?
Good fighters?
Oh, excellent fighters. They didn't flap easily, you know? They got the job done. And then we stayed, I'd say 3 or 4 weeks doing that, the better part of a month. Then they pulled us out and got us ready for Leyte, which was in October.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you were pulled out of the front lines,
we would not, unless it was a short operation, like Attu, Kiska, Makin, Kwajalein, were all fairly short operations. The first one, Attu, was a month-long operation, but nobody knew it was going to take that long. So we stuck in it till the end. Normally, in a larger operation, like with the Philippines, we would stay until the battle was, let's say, 20 miles inland. Then they would pull us. Once all of the support and logistical people came ashore, they'd pull us out.
Okay.
And we would get ready to go on the next one.
Where did you usually go for R&R?
Not far. We never got back to Hawaii. Once Kwajalein was the last one. After Kwajalein, we went all the way. We just kept going west. Yeah. As I recall, I think we did some R&R on Manus Island, which was a nothing place, and in the Admiralties at Hollandia, we did some R&R, which I didn't appreciate too much because I caught dengue fever. But
how does that affect you?
It's like malaria, but they tell you that it doesn't. It's not permanent. I did have some recurrences for a year or so after I got out of the service, but then, it was okay.
Now, when you're on R&R, what type of activities did you have?
Largely, they'd send you to a place where there was a PX or a service club, so-called, 3.2 beer. You did lots of drill, lots of calisthenics, mm-hmm. training, always training. You'd go out on amphibious training exercises. That's what the R&R was all about. They didn't want us to get rusty.
So your next landing is at the Philippines?
After Aitape, yeah. Aitape was in June. We did that for a little over a month. Then we went back to the to Manus, where we got ready for Leyte. And for Leyte, we were again attached to the 7th Division, I think it was. And we were in the first wave at Leyte Gulf.
What was the landing on Leyte like compared to the other landings
you had? Getting ashore was not nearly as bad as Makin or Kwajalein. First of all, the Japanese had more room to maneuver. And when you hit a small coral atoll, you know, they were there to throw you off immediately. So there was it was tough landing. Leyte, as I recall, going in was not as bad as we thought it was going to be. Once we got ashore, we caught mortar fire and some machine gun fire. There were some counterattacks. As I recall, the immediate objective when we landed on Leyte was the town of Tacloban, where there was an airstrip. And the objective was to get to Tacloban so they could capture that airstrip and bring in air support. And I think in about 2 or 3 days, we were close to Tacloban. And once we got 18 or 20 miles in so that they could land artillery, you were just about beyond the range of battleships and things. So that was it, and they pulled us back. The thing that complicated Leyte was that they did pull us back to the beach. And then, of course, just after the landings at Leyte, the Battle of the Philippine Sea took place. I don't know if you remember that or not. That was a major battle of the Pacific War, a naval battle. And when they found out that the Japanese task force was bearing down, and actually they didn't know about it until the last minute, because it came through the straits between Leyte and Luzon rather than seaward. So the Navy didn't want to get caught bottled up in there. So every ship was yanked out of there, even the LSTs that were on the beaches. And what happened was they were told to dump everything they had. And the beach suddenly became this massive, chaotic place with piles of ammunition and all kinds of supplies and everything, and the Navy just took off.
How did you feel when you see the Navy just heading off?
Well, you realized you were on your own now, you know. And as a matter of fact, for a while there was an alert because they thought that if the land force got word of it, they would counterattack. What did happen, however, was that we were subject to some pretty intensive kamikaze attacks by air.
The infantry.
We were on the ground.
Oh, really?
The Japanese from Manila and other places sent air strikes in with kamikaze pilots.
So they were attacking ground forces?
Yes, they were. Well, the beaches.
The beaches.
And
trying to get ammunition?
Anything they could. And as a matter of fact, I was wounded in one attack in which there was a huge pile of ammunition of all kinds. And a kamikaze pilot dove literally into that pile of ammunition and set it off. And for about 24 hours, it was murder.
The ammunition kept popping off.
Oh, everything.
Was this your first experience with kamikazes?
Yeah. At Okinawa, they were really bad. But our first experience was on Leyte when they came in on the beaches.
What did you think of this phenomenon?
Oh, well, we'd been told about it.
We had.
Yeah, we'd been told that that there were such things and to expect them. But, you know, until they happen, you don't know what they're like. As a matter of fact, the day that we were pulled off of Leyte, we were up toward a small village called Manawag, as I recall, which was inland about a mile and a half. And we had a little encampment there. And then they told us we were leaving to get ready for the Luzon invasion. They were pulling us back, and we were. They had some LSTs up on the beach. And we were to go back and go aboard. And just as we got to the beach, the siren went off and for an attack, and in came the Japanese planes. And I remember there were several, there were about eight of us, I think, and two or three of us dove under a big truck that was pulled up on the side of the road where the beach, it came down to the beach. And we dove under this truck. The other four or five raced like hell and ran up the ramp of the LST. And as luck would have it, one of the kamikazes came down and dove right into the fantail of that LST, blew the back end right off. And two of our guys were killed in that. We were just lucky that we dove under the truck.
Now, did these units pretty well stay together, or were we broken up for different?
The JASCO units?
Yeah, you're...
We were together. We would get some replacements if we had casualties, but we stayed together to the very end.
Tight-knit group?
Quite. It had its politics and its divisions. There was a group of fairly hardcore Southerners, mountain guys. There were some guys who had come from the National Guard. There was a small crew among us who had been in the CCCs, the Civilian Conservation Corps, and come in that way when the war broke out. And there were even several, believe it or not, who had been out west in California, and they were itinerants, mm-hmm. and got picked up for vagrancy. And they told us that the judge, in those days, this was just before Pearl Harbor, that the judges in some of those small towns would say, you can take, you can sign up for the army, or you can take a year in the county jail. And so they took the army.
So there were various cliques within
the... There were groups and cliques, yeah. We had a group that the technical people had all come, we'd come out of, after basic training, we'd been sent to a place called the Coyne Radio and Electrical School in Chicago. It was a civilian school. And we were sent there and lived in Chicago for several months until we got our finished our training. And then we're sent to join this unit.
The the morale was generally pretty good in the group?
I would say now, from hindsight experience, it was excellent, because they griped all the time. And you know what they say, if a unit isn't griping, it's not much good.
What were the officers like?
Some of them were somewhat removed from the rest of us. There were some officers who usually stayed on the comm ship and directed stuff from there. The officers who went ashore with us were pretty much this, you know, one of the guys.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, our sergeant, until a few months, Sergeant Kominsky, who was my unit sergeant, we were together for the whole, through that whole business right to the end. I spoke with him only about 6 months ago, and he had still been in touch with our lieutenant, Lieutenant Blaylock, I remember his name.
Did you get mail?
Interesting you should ask that question. We got it periodically. There would be mail call. I remember on Okinawa, we got one delivery of mail between Banzai charges. the Japanese had been driven to the end of the island, and because we were going up both coasts, they needed fire support, so they kept us on. And our commanding officer, and I won't use any names, but he always managed to stay aboard the ship. And you may recall that if you've read some history of World War II, that General Simon Bolivar Buckner was in charge of that. He was killed on Okinawa by some shrapnel. And they brought in Vinegar Joe Stillwell, General Joseph Stillwell, who evidently was getting under Chiang Kai-shek's skin, needling him a lot and sending home very negative reports. And the Chiang Kai-shek lobby was pretty strong, and I guess they had to find something for him to do, so they turned the Battle of Okinawa over to Vinegar Joe. And I guess he came in there like a dose of salts, and one of the things he did when he came aboard was he found out that certain unit commanders hadn't been in combat. They'd been directing it from board ship. So he ordered all unit commanders ashore. And he made our commander go ashore with a jeep and bring the mail to us.
So the mail was just sporadic?
It was sporadic. We would get it between, we were so mobile all the time. We'd get pulled out and it wouldn't catch up with us till we were just about ready to go somewhere else.
On a good time, what was the amount of time from sending it to receiving?
The mail?
Yeah.
God, I don't know. All I know is I was constantly, my parents were constantly writing that they never heard from me. I wrote some letters, but, you know, first of all, in the kind of unit that I was in, there wasn't a hell of a lot you could write home about because most of it was censored. So, except for occasionally sending a letter to say I'm fine, you know, there wasn't much else to say.
How many Christmases did you spend?
Well, I went in September of...
Let's change it.
Yeah. I went in September of 42. Right after Pearl Harbor, and was mustered out literally the day, within a day. I came in September 24th, 1942, and was mustered out at the same place at Fort Dix, New Jersey, September 25th, 1945. So it was 3 years. The first 3 months that I was in the service, I got one furlough. I went home for 6 days, I think, or something like that. And then after that, just kept going west.
Now, Christmas in combat, was just another day? Or?
Yeah, well, I'm trying to recall. December, let's see. We went into Leyte, and then I'm hazy on the dates. I'm not sure where we were Christmas of 45 now.
Any effort to make it a special occasion?
They would try to, if we were ashore and we were not in actual combat, they would send us to a rear echelon or something where you could get a hot meal. Most of the time ashore, we were either on K or C rations.
What were those like?
Well, we were constipated a good deal of the time. But, you know, hot meals, you'd go back to the ship. One of the good things with our unit, because we were small and we're not permanently attached to anybody, and often would be attached to the whatever convoy was going, we would make out better than most of the GIs because they would attach us to the bridge of the ship for communications duty to back up the sailors, to spell them. And so we would get to eat in the Navy mess while we were aboard ship, and that was much better, of course.
So Okinawa was a big landing for you?
That was a rough one. We were attached, my little communications unit, we were attached to the, I believe it was the 42nd Infantry and the 2nd Marine Division. And I believe my little communications unit went in with the 2nd Marines at Okinawa. And there, the landing was a really tough landing because, for one thing, it's a very mountainous island. The Japanese were really dug in caves. They also had the heaviest artillery we'd ever come up against, 220 caliber guns. And they were like on the sides of the opposite mountains. They'd shoot over the mountains at you. So they let us come ashore, but almost immediately after landing, they opened up with everything they had. So the beach was really messy. Mortars, as I recall, 220 caliber shells, a lot of machine gun fire. and it was rough to get off the beach. Mm-hmm. We did our usual thing. We found a fairly sheltered thing, dug in, set up the radios, and began sending messages back for fire support, for whatever was needed. Eventually, they did get off the beach, and we, you know, we stayed with that. I got pulled off about a week into the battle at Okinawa. I got pulled off duty. Ernie Pyle, the war correspondent, had come to do some interviews, and since I had some journalistic background, and from time to time, among other duties, the unit assigned me to be the combat correspondent to report on stuff for Yank magazine. So they pulled me off, and for two days I went with Ernie Pyle, taking him around to various units on Okinawa to do interviews.
What was he like?
He was just a wonderful guy. He was responsible, literally, for my ending up going to Indiana University as a journalism major.
Why was he a good reporter?
Why? Basically, because he got all the facts straight. He did not accept handouts from the brass. He would talk only to the enlisted people, very rarely. He talked to some brass, but they had to be people with the enlisted people. And he, you know, he got the unvarnished facts from the GIs. Mm-hmm. He also knew how to find the human interest in every story. But I literally was one of the people that sort of walked with him down. They were loading up to go to Aishima, a small island off the coast of Okinawa, which was going to be a cleanup operation, just a couple of patrols, really, and he went with them. And I helped put his gear aboard the landing craft, and that's the last I saw of him.
Now, so you're a reporter for Yank.
Yeah.
How did that, what did you report on?
Well, we weren't able to tell anything ahead of time, but after the fact, you could write up
you know, you could interview people, you could write up events that took place either, you know, in any of the campaigns you were on, and then you would submit them, of course, to the Yank people, who would run them through the censor, and then they'd end up in Yank magazine.
Things fairly heavily censored? Or?
Oh yeah, it was like Stars and Stripes. It was, except instead of a newspaper, it was a magazine format.
Mm-hmm. That a good assignment?
I enjoyed it because it gave me a chance to write. And I did it until I went home.
The Japanese soldier, how would you characterize him?
Tough as nails. committed, literally committed. They would, the only time I recall seeing any prisoners at all, after Kwajalein, I think there were five or six that were taken, and that's because they were wounded and hadn't the resources to kill themselves. Everywhere else, they were they would fight until they were beaten, and then they would die. On Okinawa, for instance, when we finally isolated them at the far end of the island, we had bullhorns and translators who tried to tell them. And by the way, on Okinawa, there were also Japanese civilians who were sent there, you know, to colonize the place. And they were with the troops. And we tried to coax them in to give themselves up. And some of them killed themselves with hand grenades. And others went to a cliff at the end of the island and just jumped down on the rocks and were killed. Mothers with little children in their arms did that. So they were really committed people.
The Okinawa campaign for you lasted about how long? Did you go the entire length?
Yeah. I'm fuzzy on the date we landed now, but we went all the way through April. A couple of months. That was a tough campaign. The Luzon campaign was not an easy campaign either, as I recall, largely because the plan of attack was changed. Originally, the maps we were given, we were landing in Lingayen Gulf. And if you look at a map of the Philippines, there are two sets of hills and mountainous terrain down the sides of the island. Mm-hmm. And then there's a valley in between. The original plan was to hit the beach at Lingayen Gulf and run right down that valley to Manila, cut the island in half. Also because there were both civilian and military prisoners in Manila being held in prisons and stuff, and they wanted to liberate those people. MacArthur wanted to capture Manila intact if he could. For some reason, toward the end, before we landed, we got other maps, and we went, instead of going down the valley, we went down the coastal areas. And some of that was literally hill to hill to hill. I can remember outside of Baguio, which is called the summer capital of Luzon, because it's up in the hills. And I can remember there was one large mountain that we must have gone on to. We were there for communications for fire support. We must have gone onto that mountain at least three or four times and got thrown off three or four times before they actually secured it. Heavy casualties, really. There was a rumor going around. One of the rumors was that many of the wealthy landowners who owned plantations in the valley were close personal friends of MacArthur's, and that he was trying to do as much as he could for their plantations not to be torn up. If that's so, We paid a hell of a price for that territory.
You you first went into combat at age?
Well, I went in, when I went in the service in 1942, I was just 20 years old. December, I was born in December of 1922. Okay. So in 1942, I was just 20.
Well, you went into combat first?
And that year, 43, okay. In 43, so I was just, and I wasn't yet 21.
Did your feelings evolve, your thinking evolve from the first time you went into combat till you change you as a person?
Oh, I think I wasn't the same person that came out, who went in.
What changed?
Oh, a lot of things. It's impossible for you to see death and that kind of human degradation and not be affected by it. I can remember in Leyte, as we were advancing on, we had left the village of Manawag and we were advancing toward Tacloban, and we set up a communications setup. And across the road, all of a sudden there was a commotion. And of course, coming from the village of Tacloban, trying to reach the American lines, were civilians. Once the Filipinos heard the Americans had landed, they began streaming toward the beaches to greet, you know, they were waited to be liberated. And I remember my sergeant said, "What the hell's going on over there? See what that's all about, Elisha," you know. So I ran across the road. I had my carbine just in case, you know. One thing you had to be very careful of in places like the Philippines where there were a lot of civilians was that Japanese didn't try to get in among them. And the commotion was, there was a ditch or where a shell had landed, etc., on the side of the road, and there was a woman lying in the ditch, and she was giving birth. And so then there were some units going by, you know, toward the front, and they had medics with them, and I yelled for a medic, and one of the medics came over, and he helped this woman give birth. And then I remember I was standing there and I shouldered my carbine and I'm keeping people away, you know. I said, keep away, stand back, you know. And then all of a sudden I hear this whang, and then he turns around and he says, "Here, take this." And he had it wrapped in something, I don't know, a khaki towel or something, and he handed it to me while he finished up with her, and then he took her and gave it back to her. But I'm standing there in the middle of this, you see guys on stretchers waiting to be taken back, you know, and people, and you could hear the gunfire and everything else. And here you're standing with a newborn baby in your arms. And, you know, that affected me tremendously. But all of these things, you know, I think what affects you mostly is that you see life and death in such basic terms. Cheek by jowl, as it were, and that is bound to affect you.
Now, did your unit have much of a turnover?
We were pretty lucky. I'd say we had about somewhere between 30% and 40% casualties, but many of those were not, I later found out, you know, you'd see them taken away and you wouldn't know what became of them. I later found out that not as many were fatal as many other units were. We were lucky. And by rights, if you look at the odds, going into that many landings, we had 8 combat landings, And all, not all of us, but a number of us, like myself, were literally in the first wave of every landing. And we would talk about it. The last couple, I remember we were saying, you know, if we come out of this one, we're, you know, it's a miracle because we were pushing the odds. And literally, I remember the day that they dropped the bomb on Hiroshima, we were in a bivouac area outside of Manila. And we had been quarantined because they brought us together and they gave out maps of Tokyo Harbor. Mm-hmm. And we began to get orientation for the next one, which would have been the landing in on Japanese soil itself. And I don't think many of us would have come back from that one.
So how do you view Truman's decision?
Oh, I don't think there was a person in my unit who would have argued with it, you know.
How do you view it now?
I have a great sense about, and I know all the arguments, you know, about us, what we did to Dresden, for instance, and the firebombings, and what we did to Hiroshima, and the other Japanese city.
Nagasaki.
But, you know, wartime, once the war has begun, I think splitting hairs over so-called ethical questions is an exercise in futility. Largely because, you know, we didn't start the war. Nobody talked about ethics when Hitler leveled the city of Amsterdam and Rotterdam with Stuka dive bombers. You know, all of these things, the Japanese, look what happened on the death march to Bataan, you know. I think that a commander, and even a commander of a small unit, has a horrendous decision to make. He's faced with a decision of what must be done at that given moment to achieve an objective and end that battle or that war. And you cannot expect him to think, well, we're going to kill all those people, when he's looking at his own people being killed at the same time. I mean, what's a good killing and what's a bad killing? You know, we should have thought of all that before we began it all. And someone could say, well, the real culprits are the people who allowed Hitler to become what he was, and Hirohito and Tojo to become what they were. But, you know, it was done. So then, and I think, you know, that's the lesson that for me is the strongest. When I see lessons not being learned today, when I see, and I don't give a damn about whether or not there's a stable government in Iraq or not, but when I see George Bush Sr. end the war and come home and declare victory and leave the mechanism in place for the next war as he did with Saddam Hussein, I mean, that's unconscionable, because somebody else is going to have to go clean up that mess. And that means other Americans will someday have to fight and die, which is exactly what happened. So, you know, I'm hoping that somebody in Afghanistan right now or wherever it is will take note of all these lessons that we learn in a war and do something to make certain it doesn't happen again. But once it's happening, for a person to stop and say, well, you shouldn't do this because that's unethical, but this is okay because that's a clean killing. You know, like we talk about clean and dirty bombs.
Mm-hmm. You served both with Army, you know, you were in the Army.
Yeah.
You served with both Army and Marines.
And Navy. And Air Force.
And Air Force. Particularly looking at the Army and the Marines. How do you, what's the difference?
Well, I had a good chance to see that because we were trained by Marines. Our unit, there being no such unit around, when we were formed, they took us to Camp Pendleton, and the people who developed this concept, Colonel Carlson and Roosevelt, their unit that had landed on Makin was the one that trained us. And so for the better part of 8 or 10 weeks, we were at Camp Pendleton, the Marine camp, and trained with and by Marines. Our unit, I would say, looking at my own unit, it had a great esprit de corps. We felt ourselves something apart because of the kind of work we did. And you develop that esprit. For instance, I can remember most of us sported beards. I used to get kidded about mine because of my age. But once we had been to Attu and seen combat, nobody told us to shave. You know, we were the tough, grizzled veterans, and we, as long as we kept them trimmed, it was okay. But it was sort of like a badge. We were those grizzled guys that had seen combat, you know. And I guess we became more and more grizzled with every operation. But the thing that the Marines had was that from the very beginning they were told they were something apart and different, that they had a courage unlike others, that they had unique abilities, etc. But I have to tell you that in every instance, I cannot look back on a single campaign in which I was involved, in which every single one of those units did not distinguish itself with outstanding courage and ability. The 165th Infantry at Makin was one of the finest units I've ever seen in wartime. I've never seen anyone flinch from anything they had to do. And they went ahead and they did it professionally with courage and competence. 7th Division, which really was sent into Attu, was a hell for the people that went in. We weren't given the right clothes, we didn't have enough ammunition or logistics ashore. I watched a Banzai charge on Attu, in which you just prayed that they didn't get to your foxhole, because we were in tundra, which is not like earth. It's this grass and it holds water. And we were frozen in there, and the Japanese came down, many of them with bamboo poles with bayonets on them. And you could hear guys yell because they couldn't get to their weapons. They were frozen and they were just bayoneted and gutted in their foxholes by the Japanese, who wore heavy clothing, etc. But we were told, we went in there in just before Memorial Day in May, and we were told we'd be out in a week. And of course, 2 days after we were there, we were into blizzards and everything else. And there were more men that died of frostbite there than there were of other things.
Did you notice or experience any discrimination?
Some.
Either religious or ethnic?
Yeah. In my unit, I was one of four people who were Jewish. There were guys that I literally went through hell with. We would share foxholes. We would repel Banzai charges together. When it was all over, they'd call me Jew boy. Oh yeah, hey Jew boy, you going to town tonight? You know. It was a discrimination tinged with some camaraderie. But, for instance, after Okinawa, I can remember back, we went back to the Philippines and we were waiting to see if we were going to go to Japan or not. And we were in a big tent. And I can remember a poker game started, and one of the, a staff sergeant by the name of Neuer, who was one of the Jews with me, was in that poker game, and they began to talk about going home and getting civilian clothes. And one of them said, well, go to one of those sheeny shops in Brooklyn, because Neuer was from Brooklyn, and see if we can, can't get a good deal, Jew them down on a suit of clothes. And then they began talking about different experiences of how they were gypped by Jews. And a fight broke out, in which I was a party. And there were like two or three of us against 20. And my sergeant, Elmer Kominsky, who was quite a guy, came in and knocked some heads together and told them off. In effect said, you know, these guys saved your ass a couple, not too long ago. What the hell's the matter with you assholes? And but those things did happen.
Did how is, did being Jewish, did that affect you in common? Did your experience as a
Well, not really. There were times, let's put it that way, there were times. But then there were other times when the hell was so hellish you shared it, and religion had nothing to do with it anymore. But there were wonderful moments too. I can remember, for instance, Father Joseph, and I'm blocking on his name, the chaplain of the 165th Infantry
Regiment,
Maney, Father Joseph Maney, wonderful guy who was wounded on Makin. And the night before the landing, he was the only chaplain aboard. And I can still remember they had prayer services, they always did before a landing. And he went from service to service because he was the only chaplain, and he led a Jewish service, a Protestant service, and a Catholic service. And I remember we had one fellow in our outfit who was a Quaker, who really had a lot of trouble with guilt because he'd gone against his parents' wishes to join up. And before every landing, he was sure he was going to be punished for that. And Father Maney sat and prayed with him separately. And I still remember what he said before we went over the side to into the landing craft. He came and he made a little prayer over all of us. And he said, let's go forth among the heathen and do our duty. And he said, and I'll see you all on the beach when it's over. And he said, how did he put it? I'll see you on the beach when it's over. If I don't see you there, I'll see you in heaven. And for those of you who don't make it to heaven, the divil take you. Like this, he said, now let's get to it. Then he went over the side.
Did you... Does the idea of humor change?
Well, it gets pretty, pretty dark with each passing campaign. You know, you're making jokes toward the end about life and death, and you know, I can't remember any specifics, but I know it was, especially you know, when the humor would really get going. Toward the end, like when we were going into Okinawa, which was really a rough landing, and as you'd hit the line of demarcation, where the landing craft would speed up and streak for the beach, and be down, and there'd be guys, you know, saying, hey, you got your so-and-so, you got your diapers on, and you know, stuff like that. Guys would josh back and forth with, you know, all kinds of black humor, so to speak. And you did it because you were scared shitless, mostly. You never got over that feeling. That last dash to the beach was just, you do it with your heart and your mouth, always. Because once that ramp is down, there's nowhere to go but straight ahead, you know.
Towards the end, you know, the war is winding down.
Yeah, you hear reports, you know it. For instance, we knew VE Day came when we were up to our eyeballs in battle on Okinawa.
Do you change your attitude?
In some ways you get more apprehensive because you're this close to what you think could be the end, and you're saying, you know, what you say is, shit, if I get hit now, that's really miserable, you know.
Does that affect your performance?
Well, you know, it's a funny thing, and I've thought about this, and I have no idea what it's like now in combat, but one of the things I can never remember, the people I was with not doing 150% of the job they were sent there to do on every single operation. I mean, you would go beyond, you know, you would rack your brain how to get it done better, how to do it better. And for me, I have to say this, as you can tell, I have a great affection for the man who was my sergeant of my unit. And he said an interesting thing, and I don't know how he got this wisdom because he'd never been in combat before. He'd been in the service because he was a National Guardsman who got, you know, mobilized. But he said, look, Elisha, he said, let me tell you something. You keep your mind on what the job we got to get done here, he said, and that'll get you through. Don't think about all the other stuff. That's what might happen. This is what's got to happen. And he said, stick with me. And he was hell for leather, by the way. He got rid of his carbine. He got himself a Thompson submachine gun, which he always carried into battle. He was always in the thick of where the fighting was. And I was like within a foot of him at all times. And I had, after a while, you know, there are like, what would you call it, talismans? And for some reason, he was my immortal sergeant and my talisman. And I felt as long as I stuck with Elmer, I'd make it back. Now, we both did. But what I would do, largely, would be at the moment of greatest fear is to concentrate on the job having to be done. And it worked.
In combat, what's your biggest motivation?
Getting it over. You knew, well, that's the other thing our lieutenant used to say to us, just remember, the quicker we get these guys out of here, the quicker we beat them and take this place, the quicker we can go home. Mm-hmm. He would say that before every landing. And, you know, if you kept that in mind, that was your motivation.
You depended on your buddies a lot?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was we worked in teams anyway, so, you know, you were always, and at night, especially in the initial stages of a campaign, we would set up our perimeters, and they were all foxholes. And either you were singly very close together, or you were two people and two people and two people. So, you know, you've learned to work together. And the other thing was, on most of the The ones at Attu, Kiska, and Makin, Kwajalein, and Aitape. When we landed, the first couple of nights, silence was the rule. And you did not use your weapon, the order was, you do not use your weapon unless you absolutely must, as a last resort. You had a knife, which you were to use, or you were to use the butt of the weapon, but you didn't shoot, because that could set off a whole bunch of stuff, and nobody would know where anybody was.
Just
go
one more take.
I'm the best I can.
No, you're doing fine.
Anyway, so not being able to use conventional methods, you had to rely on all sorts of things, which meant you relied on each other. Whatever signals you set up, whatever codes you set up, etc. Also, we had, and by the way, we had with us two Navajo Indian radio operators also.
Code talkers.
Yeah, code talkers. So
they were with you throughout the whole...
Yep.
What were they like?
Oh, they were great. And they would talk back and forth in their language. And so that way, when we would use plain language, we knew that we weren't going to be intercepted.
Mm-hmm. Did you get to know any?
Yeah, I got to know one of them pretty well, largely because several times I helped him home when we were still in the States and when we were in Hawaii. We used to help each other a lot that way. If somebody got a little too much to drink or something, we'd see that they all got home okay.
They were fairly well accepted?
One of them was, one of them wasn't. They were both called Chief, naturally. And one of them was fairly garrulous, and he got along fairly well. But you know, there was the same kind of bigoted camaraderie as I had to put up with. Mm-hmm. They'd make, damn Indians can't ever hold your liquor, stuff like that, you dumb Indian, things of that sort went on. But you know what? Thinking about it now, we had some Polish guys, and they called them Polacks and squareheads, This went on between groups in the whole outfit. Mm-hmm. It was almost like a style of the time.
Would you see that the same degree in a combat in an infantry combat?
Oh yeah, when you'd go aboard the troop ships, hear it all the time. Hey, Polak, all the time.
So your last campaign was Okinawa?
Yes, that was the last one. And as I said, we went back to a bivouac area outside of Manila, and we were quarantined, and we were literally studying the maps for the landings in Tokyo Harbor when the bomb was dropped.
And where do you go next?
We were put aboard ship. By the time we got aboard the ship, we were waiting to hear, and they used a point system. And of course, we had been in so many combat landings. Our officers told us we'd get back among the first, and we did. I forget how many points you needed, but I had like 141 points or something like that. So then they took us down to the harbor, they put us aboard a ship, and I remember ours was either the first or second ship back that ran with all lights going.
Hmm. What was the feeling going back?
Oh, it was great. No, I take it back. We went blackout and in convoy from Manila to Hawaii, Honolulu. At Honolulu, they put us aboard a ship that had been the cruise ship Lurline. And it had lights strung from stern to bow. And all the lights aboard went, and we went from Honolulu to San Francisco.
What were your thoughts about seeing San Francisco coming into view?
Oh, they were great. And I remember we went ashore, and we met a cab driver. We were taken to an area, and they said, you're going to be here for a few days, and they gave us passes, clean uniforms, got us all our combat ribbons, and we went into town. And I remember the cab driver at the gate at the Presidio saying, one of us said, where can we got to get some money, we haven't been paid. And the cab driver said, are you kidding? You guys won't be able to buy a drink.
Was he right?
Yes, he was. It was the city was wide open waiting for us. And then they took us to outside of LA by truck, mm-hmm, after a few days, and we waited there a week, and you'd wait for your number to come up. And we were near an airfield, and what they were doing was they had a bunch of old C-47s, mm-hmm, and with bucket seats. And as Air Force guys were being mustered out, they'd give them a plane to fly back to the East Coast. They'd load 40 guys aboard, and that's how they sent you back. We went back to Newark that way. And it took 21 hours on a C-47. We went from LA to Denver to Kansas City to New York.
What was the first thing that you wanted to do that you hadn't done in, I don't know how many years, 3 years, when you got stateside? There's something that you had been thinking about?
That I'd been, thinking about?
Something you wanted to eat, something you wanted to do.
Oh, I wanted to sit at a table, because we had eaten so much on the ground and out of cans. I wanted to sit at a table. I wanted to sit at a bar. I remember I wanted to sit at a bar and order a drink and look around, you know? Because, see, when we had joined this outfit, when we had come west from Coin Radio School to join the outfit, the rumor was, we had no idea where we were going. And the rumor was they had come a couple of weeks before, they had come to the school, some brass, and they'd given these tests, and I believe I'd mentioned this. I studied my head off to make those tests. And the rumor was they were going to have this giant radio station on the top of the mark, and we were going to get to operate it. And of course, we didn't. So all the way across the Pacific, we kept saying, when I get back, I'm going to the top of the mark and have a drink in the bar. And we did.
You did get to do that.
Yes, I did. And we went to the end of this bar, and it was just gorgeous.
Where'd you muster out?
Fort Dix, New Jersey, exactly where I mustered in.
Okay, and then?
A day after the year.
And then what did you do?
Believe it or not, I was with several other guys who got mustered out same day. We were from the same unit. And one of them was from Brooklyn, and the other one was from Rochester, New York. And they said, hell, we're not going home right away. We're going to New York City and tie one on. So I joined them, and we went to New York City for 2 days and had a ball. And then went our separate ways. I went home to Asbury Park, New Jersey.
Mm-hmm. What was homecoming like?
Well, by that time I'd called my parents, and I told them I had a stop to make first. Didn't quite tell them where. And I told them when I'd be home. By the time I got home, there was a huge, in my hometown, there was a huge party, get together, and and that was it.
How'd your parents react after?
I had trouble with my mother, who didn't understand who I was yet, who thought, you know, it would be just like the day before I went away. And there was some difficulty there.
Really?
You know, yeah, getting back. Well, they wouldn't leave you alone, you know, and they wouldn't allow you to, they didn't realize that you had been, you had a life for 3 years, making life and literally life and death decisions. And now you didn't want anybody to tell you, you know, where to go, what to do, when to do it, when not to do it, everything else. And they were just being who they were, but they didn't realize that you'd gone far beyond that. And my father realized, because he had been in combat in World War I. He pretty much left me alone. He took me out for a drink a couple of times, you know, just the two of us, man to man. But I had difficulty with my mother, and with many civilians who didn't understand. Got in big trouble with a cousin of mine, I still remember, gave a party in New York City, which I went to. I hadn't even bought a civilian suit yet. I had my ruptured duck insignia on. And this guy who had been a 4F, a lawyer, and here was this apartment down near University Place in New York, and jammed with people, great cocktail party. And this guy came up to me and looked at all the ribbons and everything, and he says, "I guess you had a pretty rough time, didn't you?" And I said, "Well, yeah," like this. You know, I didn't really want to talk to anybody about it. And he said, "Well, you think you had it rough?" He said, "Do you know, we couldn't get a can of bumblebee salmon for 3 years." And something just hit me, and I came up from the floor. Literally, I decked him. And of course, he was a good friend of my cousin's. And everybody sort of looked and said, "See, that's what they're coming back like."
Interesting.
Yeah, I could see these people talking, looking at them.
How'd that make you feel?
I left the party, went a few doors down the block to where there was a bar, and saw a couple of GIs in there, and went in, like, you know, to be at home.
How long did it take you to
acclimate? Well, I still remember, I embarrassed my father terribly. I lived in a small town of Bradley Beach, about a mile from Asbury Park. My father was in a store there where he worked. I came to have lunch with him. And we were coming out of the store to go across to a luncheonette. And at just about that time, a car backfired. And I did a full splat right down like that, middle of the street. I mean, it was reflex, you know. I heard this bam, and I just went down. You know, I hit the dirt. And he looked around, "What the hell's the matter with you?" I said, "Well, what do you mean, what the hell's the matter with me?" You know, I was embarrassed as hell, but.
Kept you alive.
Yeah, you know, you hear something go off, you go down.
So, do you go to work, go to school?
I got out in September, joined what they call the 5220 Club, get my bearings, and began writing letters to colleges. And then by January, I'd gotten an acceptance from Indiana University, and I went out there for the January term.
And you graduated from?
I graduated from IU in August of 48.
GI Bill?
GI Bill, and I worked on the side as a tutor, and you know, did odd jobs, whatever, to help. You got $75 a month, you know.
What
And I got to sit at Ernie Pyle's desk at the Indiana Daily Student in my senior year.
Must have been quite a...
Well, and I won the Sigma Delta Chi. Was giving a prize, and they decided to name it the Ernie Pyle Memorial Prize, and I was the first winner.
Well, that was rather special.
Yeah.
How would you summarize your 3+ years in service?
It was an experience. Well, I can understand what Hemingway meant when he said that for most men, it's an experience unlike none other that they will have ever had in their lifetime. And he was absolutely right. No matter what you experience, there's nothing quite like it. It's almost difficult to really explain it so that someone else can feel it. You have to have been there. It's the only way I know. I can understand the attitudes of many people who have not. I can also not understand some attitudes of people who have and still haven't learned the lessons. Having gone through it now, I wouldn't take anything for what I gained from it. And I would have to say that if necessary, if the time came, I would probably do it again for my country under the same kinds of circumstances.
Thank you very much.